understand that God is here, and he knows me. He knows what I really value. He knows what I'm thinking. He knows the things I talk about. He knows where I really invest my life. He knows where I invest my money. He knows me inside out. And so if I really know that he's present and he knows me, that will make a difference in the way I live my life. So as I was meeting with the guys from Come to Him, I thought, let me see what we can compare this to. I said, you guys, we meet here at the house. We're there in the dining room. We're meeting around the table. Let's say some night you guys are just sitting around here and you're you've got your feet up on the table and you're telling stories and you're laughing and you're talking about people in ways you ought not to be talking about them, and you're using words that you ought not to be using, and you're telling stories that you really ought not to be telling, and all of a sudden the door opens up and in walk Nancy Schultz and Paula Vallabelle. These are two ladies that on Wednesday night put on the most amazing feed for our church. And you know that they love you. You know that they would do anything for you. And they walk in the door in the midst of your stories, in the midst of a bunch of crude language. And what do you do? Do you sit there and just go, just a minute, ladies. You just continue with your stories. You continue with your language. What do? Boom, your feet are all come down on the floor and you stand up and you greet them. You have a sense of fear of these ladies, not because they're going to take you down. They're not going to. Well, they might take you down. But it's really out of an amazing sense of who they are. And their presence in the room changes everything. Folks, when we fear God, when we know who we're dealing with, this God of Israel, who would not put up with complacency or arrogance or apathy, when people realize that he's in the room, they have a sense of their responsibility. They have a sense that God is breathing life into them, that he's given them time. We have a sense of understanding, folks. God has given me, who knows, how much time do I have left? Last week I asked you to put your fingers up to your neck and feel the pulse in your veins. Somebody said to me afterwards, man, that was a sobering thought to feel my blood, my heart beating and my pulse. Who knows how many times I have left? People who fear God say, God has given me life, and I'm here to represent Christ to the world around me. I don't want to be apathetic. I don't want to be complacent. I don't want to be arrogant. I want to take the message to the people around me. Is that you? Do you realize that you have a life, and God has given you and me just a certain amount of time? Some of us longer than others, but we have just so much time. But he wants us to take Christ into those relationships and share the truth of the gospel with the people around us. And so he's saying to the people at Rome in these three chapters, don't be complacent. And he says the same to all of us. Consider, therefore, the stern, verse 22, the kindness and the sternness of God. You might write, if you're using your notes right there, you might just write down this reference and look it up later. But I'm just going to just tell you what it says. In Hebrews chapter 12, verses 4 through 11, Hebrews 12, 4 to 11, in there, there's these verses, this verse that we've heard. The Lord disciplines those whom he loves. Sometimes he comes up to me and would in a sense say to me, wait a second. Are you just kind of just standing there doing nothing about this relationship with me? Are you paying attention to the time that I've given you? Sometimes he's done that through some inspiring challenge that a child has given me. Other times it's been when a person, some person in this very room has told me how they've shared Christ with a friend. And I've been challenged to take my life and this beating heart seriously and realize I only have so long. Am I going to take advantage of that while God gives me time? I was thinking about this when Israel said, "Well, we've all got TiVo. I don't know if you have TiVo. I don't know if you have a what's the word? DVR. That's thank you. Brain freeze. If you've got a DVR, you know you've probably been a little bit spoiled in life. You know, DVR. It's just it's." TV's running right now and the phone rings and you pick up the phone and you get into an extended conversation. You really wanted to see that program. And you've already discovered now you can go back to that DVR and you can back it up, get right back to where the program was, start it all over again, and life is good, right? It's so good that I'm driving down the street and somebody says something on the radio and I go, "What was that?" And I go, "I don't have a DVR on my radio." I drive by something that was really interesting on the road and I want to back it up. I can't back up life. God gives us all sorts of opportunities to communicate with people, real people, about what it is to have a real relationship with Christ. And there have been times I've missed the window. And I want to run back and say, "Why didn't I say this at that moment?" I had a man in my office not too long ago, and it's like he opened the door. A possibility of having a conversation with him about Christ. And I didn't want to rush too much. And when he opened the door and talked I've had some questions. I let that opportunity slip. I couldn't back it up. No DVR in my office or no DVR with life. Verse 25 says this in Romans chapter 11. "I don't want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers, so that you may not be conceited. Israel has experienced a hardening in part until the full number of the Gentiles has come in." You know, when you read this verse, there's a lot packed into there. But for right now, Israel has a hardened heart. As a people, Israel is not open to who Christ is. As a people, there are people inside of Israel who've turned their hearts toward Christ. It's happening. They are this remnant that Paul speaks about in these three chapters. But he's saying, for right now, Israel as a people have hardened hearts until the full number of the Gentiles comes in. When you read those words, the full number, you realize that God is dealing with people around the world, a certain number, certain people who will turn their hearts toward Christ. It's not an infinite number, and it's not an infinite amount of time. He's given us in this world a certain amount of time, and missionaries are going out all over the world and will still go out, and young people and people in their middle ages and older people will hear the call of God and will go out into distant places, places that they're not familiar with, and take the message out until the full number of those who don't know Christ have come in. But it's not just missionaries. It's also students, and it's workers, and it's retired people, people who go into their communities, into their neighborhoods, into their family, extended family, and take the messages to who Christ is to people who don't know him. And we don't know who all those people are who might one day come to Christ. But we're taking him seriously during this time, knowing that this time will come to an end. And then he turns this corner in verse 26 and he says this, "And so all Israel will be saved." Oh, I read those words. All Israel will be saved? All of Israel? Is God making this some sort of a blanket promise that every single living soul in Israel across time is going to be saved? No, his point is this, folks. There will be a day when the time of the Gentiles, that's our time, is past. There will come a day when the Lord will return and he will set up his millennial reign, his millennial kingdom. And Israel as a people will turn to Christ. Israel as a people will turn to Christ. Look at verses, the rest of that verse and the next one. As it is written, the deliverer, they're going to turn to Christ. The deliverer, that's Jesus, will come from Zion, that is Israel, and will turn godlessness away from Jacob. And this is my covenant, my promise with them, when I take away their sins. There will come a time when Israel as a people will turn to Christ. Folks, I think of all the times, go through your Bible history. Think of all the times during the days of the judges when it says that all of a sudden there was a turning of the people of Israel to God. And maybe as a people, they were more responsive to who God was and their leaders were more responsive. And then after a while, their hearts turned away from him. And it says that over and over again, this was repeated over and over again, and every man did what was right in the sight in his own eyes. What was right in his own eyes. And then people turned back to God a little bit later when another judge arose. And then everybody did what was right in his own eyes. And then another judge arose. And then everybody did what was right in his own eyes after a period of time when their hearts turned toward God. But folks, what Paul is talking about here as he quotes the Old Testament prophecy is that there will come a time when all of Israel as a people, will turn their hearts toward God. And the clock is ticking until that time when Christ returns. We are living now in the time of the Gentiles. Paul's message to the people in Rome, and his message to us here at Calvary Baptist Church and to his people today around the world is, don't be complacent. Don't be arrogant. Don't think just because you know Christ that you have this comfortable position to sit in. But rather than be arrogant, be afraid. Be aware of who's here. Be aware of his calling on your life. And live out this time that he's given us to share Christ with the world around us. May God find us obedient, every single one of us. And might he find us as a people obedient to listen to him. I think of those growth groups that Israel and Jim mentioned today that will actually begin meeting. It's after next Sunday, right, Israel? That's when this next 10-week session of growth groups begins.